She was a formidable character, Lady Gregory, and no matter what way you look at her contributions to Irish cultural and literary life at the beginning of the 20th century, it was in fact immense. I mean, you mentioned there that she was the founder of the Abbey Theatre,
yeah.
And an awful lot of people, including myself, I'd say I'm guilty of this, and it is a wrong judgment, but we tend to think of her as the sort of mentor, the benefactor to all the greats, to the Sings, to the O'Caseys,
yes,
to the Yeatses, etc., because of her position of wealth,
as
her position
lady,
of power. But you rate her as a writer.
Oh, I think she's wonderful. She never had a play produced till she was 51, and she wrote nearly 100 plays. One of the great writers of the one-act play in the world, The Rising of the Moon, caused more trouble in Ireland than 1798 Rebellion. It was so patriotic. And then there's the Workhouse Ward is a complete masterpiece done all over the world. And she was also a wonderful poet. She had a real sea change and went and she learned Irish. She went into the Royal Irish Academy, rescued documents, wrote a whole history of Cú Chulainn and the Irish sagas, and the most exquisite poetry translated from Irish. She did all these things after setting out, as you say, as a rather prim young lady from a country house, upper class.
Well, she was the epitome of the upper class. Cool Park is not exactly a semi-detached.
Well, no,
well, it's gone now, obviously, but the ground is still there.
Yeah. She married into that. Sir William Gregory was the governor of Ceylon and was an administrator in Egypt when she was 19 and he was about 106, but anyway, whatever it was, he went out there. She went out there with them, and that's where she got what you might call republicanized, because she met out there a famous English rebel, Wilfred Blunt, an aristocrat landowner and a poet who has 6 or 8 or 10 poems in the Oxford Book of English Verse Vault. I'm a great songs here. She met him, fell in love with him there, and actually became an agitator for Egyptian freedom. Came back
right.
to Ireland. Sir William is dead. She inherits this beautiful house, and she uses it like a great Roman emperor. She uses it as a place for the arts to flourish.
But when it comes down to it, she married a man who was twice her age.
Yeah.
And she became the quintessential colonial wife.
Yes, colonial wife, except that she was having this massive affair
with
Will, who, by the way, was in jail in Galway for joining the Land League, you know, afterwards, probably because...
Blunt.
And this radicalised her, but not only that, her scholarship was so fantastic, you know, and then with the scholarship she had this ability to manage to bring institutions into life and to keep them there.
Yeah, when she came back, you say she sort of held court, if you in Cool Park. And when did the literary, cultural side of her character come to fruition to the point whereby she was dealing with and looking after the greats of Anglo-Irish literature?
Well, she met Yeats in the 1890s and she was influenced by him, and then she decided with he and her and John Singh founded the Abbey in 1904. Yeah. And by 1912, they were world famous. They were the first repertory company in the English-speaking world. And that means that people would come in for life contracts, be there for life, and they would act different parts every week. One week you might be playing the snuff carrier, and the second week you might be playing the lead. And she mounted this whole structure, which became so famous that when she went to America about 1910 or 11, that New York theatres were packed. And of course the Irish were there in the first night to show their dislike, and they nearly burnt the theatre down.
Yeah, but I think we ought to explain that was the play by the Western World.
Oh, I beg your pardon, of course.
Sing's great play. I mean...
Which had also been got the same treatment in Dublin.
Well, I mean, she suffered under that, didn't she?
Well, here's a good example, though, of how her ladyship was able to work. The second night of it, she's in the box with guess who? The man who'd just been president of the United States, Ted Theodore Roosevelt. And Robert Emmett's grand-nephew. That shut those shaggers up in America, you know, the Irish-Americans there. And she went away, and she even crawled on the stage when there was another row and hid behind the sets and said, "Don't use your voices too much. We're going to pull the curtain and start again." I mean, that's the sort of person she was. She had this absolute commitment to this company whom she fed. She used to get a gigantic bomb rack made at the start of every play because she knew players were hungry. And it took two fellas to carry it up in the train from...
This was their dinner kind of thing.
afterwards, full of the most luscious things.
Yeah.
And then she used to travel third class to save money for the Abbey, while Bernard Shaw, who was travelling one day and didn't know with her, that great socialist, was travelling first class. Yeah.
But, I mean, apart from the work she did on the cultural life of the country and the Abbey, etc., politically, she must have been inculcated with colonialism and the society that she moved in, to step out of that room, so to speak,
I think
would
Blunt,
have been amazingly difficult.
I think
to
Blunt
do.
Helped a lot there, because he was a very old English aristocratic family. He wasn't just one of these fashionable Oxford Republicans, you know. Yeah. But then she came back and she determined to get in touch with the people. She went around with her notebook, collecting all the stories and phrases they had. She kept her diaries. She kept the Abbey going, and she never let it get into debt that it couldn't get out of. But finally, when
she had a good business head.
She had a brilliant business head. Yeah, and it was really, well, of course, Yeats had too. They both had that Protestant merchant thing in the background.
She was parsimonious.
Exactly. Not spending money the role. She was very like, well, do you know what she used to do? She used to nick the sugar in the hotel she was staying in, the Standard Hotel, and bring it home just for the Abbey. I mean, she was that, even though she was a rich woman.
She was that dedicated to it.
With this beautiful cool, where, as you probably know, the tree is.
I do,
Charlotte Casey and Bernard Shaw. And what happened was, the butler came in with a big knife next morning and said, her ladyship, when you were leaving, would like you to sign the tree.
The tree, yeah.
And there were guys had breakdowns because they weren't asked, you know.
The corridor of fame in a tree, or bark of a tree, yeah.
And of course, we knocked that beautiful place down, the house, in 1944. Galway County Council. Yeah. They ought to be individually crucified if any of them were alive for doing that. It was terrible.
Well, yes, but then, of course, equally, I don't think they've done a great preservation job on Moore Hall, further up there.
Well, that was burnt by the
It was burnt down, but they didn't try and do anything about it. I just wanted to ask you something, because I'm confused about this, and it's really about Joyce and Lady Gregory, but via somebody who's close to your heart, Oliver St. John Dougherty.
Yes.
And in his book, as I was going down Sackville Street, we're just going to read an extract, which I have to confess that this is the part of the introduction I wrote to this to Sackville Street
better,
14
fellow.
Years ago, whatever it was. I was talking about the whole problems that Joyce and Gogarty had. You know, they had great admiration for each other, as everyone knows, but then there was the split in the tower and all the rest of it. But out of that row comes this. This is particularly prevalent towards the latter half of the book, in his deliberations on the state of Irish theatre and the unwarranted exclusion of Joyce by Lady Gregory from the Abbey Theatre. And I'm just going to give you a quote. In this sequence, Gogarty pays tribute to Joyce's expertise, okay? And when he says, and then, direct quote from Sackville Street, Joyce knew far better than I what was in the air and what was likely to be the future of the theatre in Ireland. Who can measure how great was its loss when Lady Gregory gave him the cold shoulder? I mean, it's fairly accusatory. Whether Gogarty was reading it wrong
or
not.
Well, there's two things. First of all, Gogarty had a row with Joyce, and he also never got on with Lady Gregory for some reason or other. He never penetrated her charm ration. Maybe because, of course, as you know, by the way, she was in love with Yeats.
Yeah.
But she returned his love by getting him that wonderful wife who gave him 15 years of wonderful poetry, and that was the sort of person she was. But Gogarty didn't like her, and he was quite unfair, because there's a letter to Yeats in London when Joyce is leaving.
Yeah.
And she said, now you must meet him at the boat, Willie, and you must give him breakfast, and you must give him £2, which she sent to him that way. And generally, she encouraged him tremendously, but Gogarty didn't like her. And Joyce had written a limerick about Lady Gregory, which Gogarty always used, but it was more in fun than anything else. The most interesting thing, by the way, is that he got the word category. to rhyme with Gregory in the limerick, you see. And this is Finnegan's Wake, starting with the young Joyce.
It's like Step to a Son in Pelopones, but anyway.
And he said this to Gogarty one day, holding up his hand the way for silence, the way he used to do as a wise man. There was an old lady called Gregory who said, come to me, all poets in beggary. But she rued her imprudence when thousands of students cried, we are all in that category, you see. And that's given the impression. But in fact, he admired her greatly. And she was, that letter is so touching to Yeats, the young boys going over, to take him off the boat and give him, because he was going to Paris. That's when he was in exile.
Yeah, just to conclude on that, because we'll have to move on. I mean, and in fact, you know, looking at this again, you're absolutely right. Gogarty takes a swipe at Lady Gregory in the same thing by saying, and again from Sackville, her namby-pamby humour deadens my spirits. But there's one thing that Gogarty accused her of. Now, I'd just like to get your view on this. Again, he's reflecting in Sackville Street, and he says, how much of her plays did she write? This question he puts in the context of the many visits by Yeats to Coole Park, and gives further evidence to his suspicions by adding, I about, and this is a quote, I about got him, Yeats, to acknowledge his authorship of The Rising of the Moon.
That's terrible. I mean, I tell you, it shows how a great man and a great poet guy, Gregory, could let the... I mean, all those plays, or The Workhouse World, which is done in Russia today, was part of her great contribution. She wrote nearly 100 plays. It's hard to cog them all, isn't it?
Oh, well, indeed. But I just think it's something that needs clearing up, because we all know that Gregory was very forthright, shall I say.
He was a terrible man when he didn't like someone. He spread the most awful things about them, you know, and he just didn't get on with her, and that doesn't mean that he was bad or she was bad. It just means, you know...
We said terrible things about people he liked as well.
That's true.
Anyway, one of the things that perhaps people aren't aware of is the fact that she learned Irish and was an excellent translator of Irish works from the Irish language.
Yes. Well, that was extraordinary. She was not only a playwright and a translator, but she was a wonderful poet. Hmm. And this poem that I'm just going to give you two verses from now, it was Donal Óg. It's an 18th century Irish poem of exquisite quality, but it was pinched by writers all over the world, and they never acknowledged poor old Lady Gregory, who wouldn't give a damn, by the way.
The stars are not wanted any more. Put out every one. Pack up the moon and dismantle the sun. I mean, those are the famous words of Funeral Blues by W.H. Auden, which, of course, was a main attraction in that first-class film Four Weddings and a Funeral.
Yeah, great film.
But when you take the first couple of lines of the third verse, which is, he was my north, my south, my east, my west, it's quite blatant, isn't it?
It's quite blatant that he snaffled it for her, but that's a regular thing about poets. Poets don't mind copyright. They'd say, once I've got a bit of passion going in me, I'll steal here and there. But the thing was, Auden never gave her the credit for it, and really, he just took it and put it in. If you read the whole poem and the thing, and it's an amazing thing to see. She should have taken it from the 18th century, rescued it, and given it this lovely new life, and then it becomes one of the most... And all over the world, people were crying listening to that.
In that film...
Well, now, this is Donal Óg, and it's an Irish country girl, and Donal has left her. And she's broken-hearted, and the last four lines are the really famous lines in literature. And here's just a flavour in the beginning. Oh, Donal Óg, if you go across the sea, bring myself with you and don't forget it. Now you promised me and you said a lie to me. It was on that Sunday I gave my love to you. The Sunday that is last before Easter Sunday, on myself and my knees reading the Passion and my two eyes giving love to you forever. But you've gone now. You've taken the East from me. You've taken the West from me. You've taken what's before me and what's behind me. You've taken the moon, you've taken the sun from me, and great is my fear. You've taken God from me.